Good morning and welcome to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. I am located at 1563 Main Street in Peckville, Pennsylvania, and I am right here with you each and every Sunday at this time on this station to bring you, the landowner, the information that you need regarding natural gas development. At the Clark Law Firm, my focus is on landowner, royalty owner, property owner representation. I have not, I do not, and I will not represent gas or pipeline companies. I represent the landowner, royalty owner, property owner for such things as gas lease, negotiations, reviews, consultations, pipeline agreements, negotiated, consulted on, worked on pipeline agreements over the last 10 years with over 70 different companies in Pennsylvania to give you an idea of the type of experience and what's going on out there. Unitization issues, royalty issues, multi-unit well consent, multi-unit well consent requests, also known as production allocation agreements. Extremely hot topic now. If you are presented, and please pay attention to this because I mean it, if you are presented with a multi-unit well consent from Cabot, a multi-unit well consent or production allocation agreement from Chesapeake, I would really encourage you to give us a call. These documents can and should be negotiated, and it's very important that you understand what this is about, understand your leverage, and understand if you want to sign and should sign such a request. I do these reviews and consultations for the multi-unit well consents and production allocation agreements on a regular basis, and I really encourage you. Call the office, learn about a review and consultation, and see if it's right for you. I really encourage you to do this because these agreements should and can be and should be negotiated to your benefit. As always, we cannot leave positive items on the table, whether it be money, better terms, other commitments. You need to maximize each and every agreement. I really encourage you, really, multi-unit wells, production allocation requests. If those are presented to you, call the office 570-307-0702. 570-307-0702. And I'm sorry to get a little bit commercial there, but these multi-unit well requests, I can't say enough. Give us a call. See what we can do. See if we can help you. 570-307-0702. Also, surface use agreements, roadway agreements, buying and selling property rights, Marcellus Shale, Utica Shale regions, regardless of where you're located in the state, encourage you, give us a call. We have clients all over Pennsylvania and clients who reside in states across the country but have property or royalty rights in Pennsylvania. So again, give us a call, 570-307-0702. And do not be afraid of your distance from the office. Again, I have clients all over Pennsylvania, Greene County, Washington County, Armstrong County, my home county, Westmoreland County, Butler County, all the western parts of the state, and all, of course, across Tioga, Potter, Lycoming, all across the region, Bradford, Susquehanna, and so on and so on. So really encourage you, do not be afraid. Call and get some information. And if we're right for you, great. If we're not, that's okay. Get some information and see if we can help you. And I really encourage everybody to go to the websites. If you've not been to the websites, what are you doing? Let's get to the websites and get information, whether you are looking for representation or information. Use the websites as a resource. They're not specific advice for anybody, and neither is the radio show. But it's good general information to get some information. Understand, you can learn what we do, but get information. Understand what you should be thinking about. There's frequently asked questions, you know, pitfalls, things like that. Get educated. That's the most important thing. We need to raise the bar of education to make sure that when people are signing agreements, again, they're not leaving money or terms or limitations that they could obtain. They're not leaving those on the table because they didn't ask. They didn't get an attorney who knew what they were doing. They thought they knew what they were doing, but there are other more detailed loopholes and things, and they're everywhere. So we want to make sure that you're getting the best quality representation. These are big deals. You need to protect yourself. And it's not just self-serving because I'm an attorney. You need to do it. I'd love to hear from you, but if you don't call me, call someone who knows what they are doing. This has become very, very specialized, in my opinion. Now we're looking so much more at production, at drilling techniques, at unitization techniques, at different leverage points, pipelines. My heavens, if you're doing a pipeline agreement on your own, my opinion, you are making an enormous mistake. Enormous mistake. Many times, not all the time, many times pipeline negotiations result easily in tens of thousands and many times in hundreds of thousands of dollars in increase for what you're originally offered. Again, not all the time, but many times. The key is you have to understand your leverage and you need to maximize that leverage and do the best you can for your situation and sign a good agreement, not what they present to you. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. You can join me each and every week at this time on this station for All Things Marcellus. And you can call the office, again, multi-unit well consents. I'm just going to beat that up some because I'm really confident I can help you. So I'd like to hear from you. That's up to you, but I'm really confident. Production allocation agreements, multi-unit well consents. Give us a call, 570-307-0702. But everyone else, hey, if you don't have a multi-unit well consent or a production allocation agreement, that's just one part of what I do. It's just a really hot issue now that I really want to hear from as many people as I can because I truly believe that I can help you. And that's what we want to do. Okay. Well, I'm excited about today. Rarely, it's like a purple unicorn that we on the landowner side, on the royalty side, catch a break. You know, catch a break. There's been promises forever. Legislature's going to do this. This is going to happen here. They're going to protect the people here. They're going to protect the people there. And here we are. You know, what are we seeing? Well, something happened this week. Pretty exciting. Something happened where the Superior Court in Pennsylvania made a potential landmark decision, if not a landmark decision, that benefits certain Pennsylvania landowners to the detriment of the companies. Let me say that again. Again, our purple unicorn here. We got a case that benefits a certain group of Pennsylvania landowners, and it doesn't benefit the company. This is a big, big, big decision. Now, it only affects a certain group of people, but it's a big, big deal. And it actually is going to spill over, I believe, and affect a lot more people in lease negotiations. So check this out. We're going to do kind of a case review, and I'm going to get into it and explain how it benefits Pennsylvania, certain Pennsylvania landowners. And this is really a big deal, really a big deal. So what am I talking about? It is the case of Briggs versus Southwestern Energy Production Company. Briggs was the landowner. Southwestern Energy Production Company, often called Southwestern, was the gas company. So here's the deal. I'm not going to get into all the procedure aspects that gets very technical, but we're going to talk about the meat and bones of this thing. So what's this case about? And again, this is big. What is it about? Well, Southwestern, as the gas company, leased property in a certain area, in a place in Susquehanna County. And there was a parcel immediately adjoining or next to all of the other parcels that Southwestern had leased in that area. But this particular landowner did not enter into a lease with Southwestern. This landowner did not have a lease, but the people around this landowner and his or her, we'll say his property, they were leased to Southwestern. So Southwestern creates a production unit. They designate a geographic area, you know, an area of property. Let's pretend, they'll just make this up, 600 acres, say. So they designate an area around, you know, we'll say it's 600 acres. But the point is, this parcel that Mr. Briggs owns was not leased to Southwestern. And this parcel that was unleased was located next to or close proximity to a horizontal well. So let me explain that. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. So you have a horizontal well that's underneath the ground that goes out, we'll say it goes straight down, let's pretend it goes 7,500 feet. So it goes straight down 7,500 feet, and then it goes out horizontally. I'm going to make these up for illustration of this. Say it goes out 5,000 feet. Well, where it goes out 5,000 feet through the Marcellus Shale, this landowner, Mr. Briggs, his property was close to where the well went out horizontally, but he wasn't leased. So when Southwestern went out and they drilled the well, they hydraulically fractured the well, and they started extracting gas from the well. Now again, Mr. Briggs, his property is not leased to Southwestern, and it is located in somewhat close proximity to this horizontal well. So the question is, if Southwestern's well that they hydraulically fracture and then gas comes into the well and then it goes up to the surface, if that well, when they fractured it, was receiving gas or taking gas from an area around the well, if that area included Mr. Briggs's property, who is not leased to Southwestern, so if that well is extracting gas because it's been fractured and it's getting gas from Mr. Briggs' property, but he's not leased to Southwestern, does Mr. Briggs have a claim for trespass and conversion, or we may think of it as stealing, his gas? The whole idea again, and I'm going to get real into this in the next segment, we're going to really break this down. Can a company drill a horizontal well in, we'll say, close proximity to another property where they're now, when they fracture it, gas from the unleased neighboring property, if gas from that property is going into that well and that neighboring property, in this case Mr. Briggs, is not leased to the gas company, in this case Southwestern, can Southwestern take whatever gas comes in that well and attribute that gas production to the unit who they have leases with, all the people in the unit? Can they pay the people in the unit for the gas that they're producing and not pay the landowner who is located next to the well but is not leased to the company? Can they not pay him anything and pay all of that royalty for the gas that they're producing only to the people in the unit? Well, stick with me, because I think you're going to like the answer. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. You can give me a call, reviews, consultations, a couple quick things. Multi-unit wells, multi-unit well consents, production allocation agreements. Should be negotiating, should be getting assistance. I really encourage you to give me a call, 570-307-0702. Learn about at least a review and consultation. I really encourage you to do that. The number is 570-307-0702. Tioga County, Sweppy, Rockdale, Marcellus, quick message for you guys. If you are shut in, and you've been shut in for ideally 7 years or more, and you're not getting royalties, I want to hear from you. We're taking this on. We are taking this on actively and aggressively. I want to hear from you. I want to see if we can help you. Give us a call, 570-307-0702. Again, we are attacking this issue, and that's who I want to hear from, because this is wrong, and this makes me, gets me a little fired up. But thankfully, I got my blood pressure squared away. So seriously, though, I really want to hear from you. If you're shut in for especially 7 years or more, Tioga County is where the big thing, we see it all the time, especially vertical wells. Want to see if we can help you, because this, in my opinion, is just flat out wrong, and we need to do something about it. 570-307-0702. All right, when we get back, we're going to dive into again more. This is a great, great case, and I'm going to explain why when we get back. Briggs versus Southwestern Energy. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Join me every week at this time at this station. I'll be right back after this break. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Remember, you can join me each and every week, and I hope you do, at this time on this station for All Things Marcellus. And if you are looking for any type of representation relative to any oil and gas issue, give us a call. The Clark Law Firm, 570-307-0702. And just real quick, remember, I'm doing reviews and consultations on multi-unit well consents. If you are given a multi-unit well consent, sometimes called a production allocation agreement, I really encourage you, call the office, 570-307-0702. I would not be pounding this point if I did not think I could help you. Give me a call. See if we can help you. 570-307-0702. And again, I know sometimes it gets to be a broken record, but I'll tell you, this stuff in Tioga County with these shut-in vertical wells, we need to stop it. If you're shut in and you've been shut in for 7 years or more, I want to hear from you. 570-307-0702. I want to look, review your lease, review your situation, and see if you may have a claim. And if you do, we'll talk about pursuing it, because we're pursuing these claims. We need to stop this. You didn't enter into a gas lease 7, 10, 15 years ago expecting with the intent that there was going to be a shut-in well that was going to be sitting there for 5, 6, 7, 8 years or more. It's wrong. It wasn't what the deal is, and we need to do something about it. So give us a call, 570-307-0702. And again, any and all oil and gas related matters. And one thing too, I haven't been doing many pipeline shows recently, but I'll tell you, same deal, pipeline agreements, give us a call. At least, like, give us a call. Think about review and consultation. Usually takes an hour or two tops, and then decide where to go from there. And if that's all you do, that's great. But, you know, find out about that service. Too many people are signing really bad agreements. I've reviewed some agreements from EOG this past week in Bradford County that just left me shaking my head. That's not uncommon. I read one from Eclipse, I think it was in Potter County, which left me pounding my head. So think about that. Reviews, consultations, get that information. Don't be afraid to call and learn. I have clients all across the state. I have clients in their 70s and 80s in the western part of the state that I represent. And we do by telephone, fax, email, even U.S. mail correspondence. So don't be afraid of distance. Learn about it. Learn about what we do, because we really want to help you out. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. So let's get back to this purple unicorn, a great case for the Pennsylvania landowner. Briggs versus Southwestern Energy Company. This was filed on April 2nd. So April 2nd, 2018. So let me kind of back set. We're going to get some facts here. So Southwestern is the gas producing company. They have a lease on a tract of land which is adjoining or next to Mr. Briggs. Mr. Briggs is the plaintiff landowner. Mr. Briggs does not have a gas lease. So Southwestern has a gas lease on property adjoining Mr. Briggs, but not on Mr. Briggs. So then Mr. Briggs, with his counsel, filed a lawsuit claiming that Southwestern was trespassing and converting, also we think of that as stealing, but trespassing and converting his gas, trespassing on his property and essentially stealing his gas. They allege also that in Southwestern's operation of its drilling unit, which would be located adjoining or next door to Mr. Briggs' property, that unit and that well, the wells in the unit, are extracting natural gas beneath Mr. Briggs' property. And Mr. Briggs, remember, does not have a lease with Southwestern. Southwestern says, no, not so fast, Mr. Briggs. In Pennsylvania, there is the rule of capture, which many people probably have heard about. This is what's great about this case. The old days when the landman, and how many out there heard it? Well, if you don't sign, they'll just steal your gas anyway. You better sign or you'll get nothing. They'll just steal your gas. And in a lot of ways, that can be true, but in a lot of ways, that's not necessarily true. And now we even have this case, which makes that type of statement even way more problematic, as we're about to get to. So, landowner says, hey, you're drilling next to my property, and the well is so close to my property, when you fracture it, you are taking gas and stealing gas from underneath my property. That's what you're doing, company. And the company says, no. Pennsylvania has the rule of capture. And the rule of capture, I'm going to explain it, we'll read it to you, is a fundamental principle of oil and gas law. And it holds that, so the rule is that there is no liability for drainage of oil and gas from under the lands of another, so long as there has been no trespass and all relevant statutes and regulations have been observed. So what does that mean? Let me break it down a little bit. So what they're saying, the rule of capture, okay, what that's really saying is that the natural, if you drill a well on your property and gas comes from another property and goes into that well, so it comes from a neighboring property and goes into your well and comes to the surface, you get that gas. You keep the gas because it came to the surface in the well you drilled. So as long as that well that you drilled does not go underneath another property, your neighbor's property, without a lease, as long as it doesn't go underneath someone else's property, if you drill a hole on your property down and gas goes into that well hole, well bore, and comes up to the surface, that's your gas, regardless of where that gas originated from, meaning whether it came from under your neighbor's property or under your property. And I'll give you, here's an example sometimes that you hear. If you're a deer hunter and you're out hunting and a deer is on your neighbor's property and your neighbor had shot the deer and the deer comes limping over to your property and then you shoot the deer, well, that's your deer. It's on your property. So again, with the gas, the idea is that natural gas is migratory. It moves around. It moves by pressure. If there's high pressure, low pressure, it's going to move. And so normally, the way gas has been extracted for many, many years in Pennsylvania has been that the conventional drilling is you drill a well straight down. And imagine an underground lake of gas. And let's pretend that gas underground lake goes under your neighbor's property and under your property. So when you drill a well into the lake, you'll hear the analogy. It's like putting a straw into that big underground lake of gas. And so think about if you put a straw in the edge of a lake and you started sucking out water, that water is going to migrate or come towards that straw. And so the idea is that no one owns the gas and you can't tell what's under your property and what's under the neighbor's. So if you put the drill, well bore, or straw down into the underground lake of gas from your property, whatever you can suck out of that lake is your gas, regardless of whether that gas is migrating from other properties to the straw that you put under your property or put down into your property. The idea is you know what can happen? Your neighbor then will put a straw or a drill down in their property, a well bore, and start sucking out of that same lake. And it becomes a race to suck as much gas as you can out of this underground lake, because the person with a well on their property is the one who's going to get the gas and the royalty. So the rule of capture essentially is whoever captures or gets the gas to the surface of their property gets to keep it. But remember, what is so critical to remember here is this was the traditional way in Pennsylvania. People were just drilling straight down vertical holes and gas would migrate to that hole. But if there were multiple holes, gas could migrate to each one. So if you didn't lease and your neighbor drilled a straight down vertical well by his property line, and there was an underground lake of gas that was underneath your unleased property and his property, your neighbor's property, your neighbor would get all the gas that your neighbor could from that well, and that would be his gas, and he would get royalties from that gas. You, who were not leased, but the underground lake, and again, envision a large lake of gas underneath the ground. That lake went underneath your property and under your neighbor's, but you weren't leased and you didn't drill. So the neighbor was allowed to take all the gas that would come up through that well and take the royalty from that. So if you didn't lease and you had an underground lake of gas under your property, your neighbor could take that gas, or some people say steal that gas, and you would not get anything. And that's the rule of capture. He who captures the gas gets to keep it. That's his gas. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Remember to join me each and every week at this time on this station for All Things Marcellus. You can call the office, learn about reviews, consultation, other representation, royalty issues, multi-unit well consents, production allocation agreements, lease modifications, reviews, ratifications, any of those, plus more. 570-307-0702. So, okay, let's reset here a bit. So, rule of capture. We'll boil it down to, we'll say that rule of capture means that there is no liability for draining oil and gas from a neighboring parcel or another parcel as long as you do not trespass, or in other words, drill. That's what we always thought, drill underneath the other property. Now, Southwestern says, hey, Mr. Briggs, hey, plaintiff, you cannot win in this case because this rule of capture bars or stops your claim. So what the argument is saying that, hey, remember, rule of capture says if gas migrates to the well bore and goes to the surface of the landowner's property, that's that landowner's gas. So they're saying, hey, yeah, we may have drilled a horizontal well beside your property and you're not leased to us, and some of your gas may have came into that well bore and came up to our well site, our well pad, and we've sold that gas. And Southwestern says, you're not entitled to any proceeds from that gas because you're not under lease. And the rule of capture says, if your gas migrates to my well, as long as my well is not underneath your property, too bad. You get nothing. But wait till you hear what happens. Let's see if they were right. We'll find out after this next super important message. Remember, you're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. You can give us a call, 570-307-0702, 570-307-0702. Join me each and every week at this time on this station for All Things Marcellus. I'll be right back after this break. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Remember, you can call the office. Reviews, consultations, multi-unit well consents. If you're shut in 70 years or more, Tioga County, I want to hear from you. 570-307-0702. And of course, pipeline agreements and any and all oil and gas needs. Give us a call. Clients all over the state. Clients who reside all over the country, have had clients all over the country with property in Pennsylvania. So don't be afraid of distance. Give us a call. See if we can help you. We want to help everyone we can. And if you're not calling us, call someone who knows what they're doing. And by the way, I do personally all the reviews and consultations. No other attorney. It's always done through me, with me. So, okay, let's get into this here. We're talking about the Briggs versus Southwestern case. Awesome case. Love it, love it, love it. Great case for the landowner. And look, we could use a break, couldn't we? So, all right. So what we're talking about real quick, in case you're just joining, we have an unleased individual named Mr. Briggs. Southwestern has drilled a well in close proximity to his property. Mr. Briggs says, hey, that well, when you fracture it, is producing gas from my property and you're not paying me. You're stealing my gas. And Southwestern says, no, the Pennsylvania rule of capture allows us to drill as long as we're not underneath your property. If your gas migrates or travels over to our well, then that's our gas under the Pennsylvania rule of capture. So, couple arguments. So Mr. Briggs argues that the extraction of natural gas from his property is a trespass, even though the well bore did not physically go or travel beneath his property. He also argued that the rule of capture was a rule of necessity caused by the inability to determine the ownership of natural gas or oil when it's located in an underground pool, or like I've said, a lake. So in other words, let me break that down a second. So what he's saying is, hey, look, the rule of capture in Pennsylvania made sense when you're dealing with an underground lake of gas. And so that makes sense because that gas can travel. If you put a well bore into it on the one side, the gas is going to migrate over to that side. If you're pumping that, you're getting that gas out of there. You put a well bore on the other side, you're going to get gas from that lake. And you can't tell exactly who owns what gas. So whoever gets to capture it, that's their gas. But Briggs says, hey, look, the Marcellus Shale, the Utica Shale, the gas is trapped in tight formations of rock. It isn't an underground lake. And when I say lake, I mean literally envision a lake and put it underground and fill it full of gas. So that, if you have that lake, it's going to move around and it can go to different properties. But gas in the Marcellus Shale layer, same Utica, and other deep hard rock formations, the gas is trapped very, very tightly in this hard rock formation. And the only way that gas is going to be extracted in any significant consequence is to fracture it, where you go ahead and you have these mini explosions where sand and chemicals and water are thrown out or shot out of the well bore. And what happens is that the sand particles will prop open the rocks. So you have these extremely tight rocks, which you then explode, and then you leave sand particles in between these rocks. So there's a gap in between the rocks that used to be extremely tightly compacted. Now that gas allows the gas to flow through them and into the well bore. So the idea being, if you just simply drilled a well into a tight rock formation, you're not drilling into an underground lake of gas. You need to fracture it. You need to do something in order to get that gas to really flow. And then the question becomes, okay, when you drill that horizontal well and you fracture from that well bore, are you taking gas? How far away are you getting gas from? And in this case, Mr. Briggs says, hey, you're fracturing this well in close proximity to my property. And as a result of fracturing the rock, you are now taking or stealing gas from my property, and I don't have a lease for you or with you. And he says the rule of capture doesn't apply, or it shouldn't apply to this type of formation, the Marcellus Shale, because this isn't an underground lake where if you do nothing, if you drilled a straight down hole, a well bore on your property, my gas isn't going to migrate over to you from the Marcellus Shale because it's not in a lake. It's tightly compacted in this hard rock formation. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Southwestern says, no, the rule of capture is Pennsylvania's law. That applies. And as long as we don't drill directly underneath you, even if we fracture this well and it's off to the side of your property and your gas comes over into our well, we're not liable to you. We don't have to pay you anything because the Pennsylvania rule of capture says, as long as we're not drilled underneath you, whatever gas migrates into our well is our gas and you get nothing. So the question is then, is there something different when you have to force the extraction of the gas? When you have to fracture the rock to get the gas to migrate to your well? Is that different than regular conventional drilling when you just have the underground lake that you drill into and you suck whatever gas you can out of that particular well? So that's the stage is set. The stage is set. So the court in addressing this issue talked about some other cases historically in Pennsylvania and other states. And one case which says under Pennsylvania law, oil and gas resources are subject to the rule of capture, which permits an owner to extract oil and gas even when extraction depletes a single oil or gas reservoir beneath adjoining lands. So that was a 2011 Pennsylvania case that held that. But what's interesting, remember, it says rule of capture applies, which permits an owner to extract oil and gas even when extraction depletes a single oil and gas reservoir located beneath adjoining lands. But remember, we're not dealing with a reservoir when we're dealing with Marcellus Shale gas. Next, court talks about Pennsylvania courts have not yet considered whether hydraulic fracturing, which extends into an adjoining landowner's property. Now, that's really important. Hydraulic fracturing, as a result of that fracturing, does it extend into an adjoining landowner's property? So is that, as a result of fracturing, hydraulic fracturing, is the neighbor's gas, because of that fracturing, is the unleased neighbor's gas now flowing to that wellbore? And it wouldn't have occurred but for fracking. So the question is, Pennsylvania courts had not decided. They had not ruled whether this subsurface hydraulic fracturing that extended to a non-leased adjoining landowner, whether that resulted in an action, whether that person whose gas is being taken, who's not under lease, whether they have an action in trespass saying, hey, wait a second, even though you're not drilled underneath me, you're stealing my gas because when you fracture your horizontal well that's close to me, that fracturing activity where you're shooting out water, chemicals, and sand to prop open this rock, that's going into my property and you're stealing my gas, even though you're not drilled under me. And that's the question. And that's the issue that this court addressed. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Make sure you join me each and every week at this time on this station for the information you need regarding natural gas development in Pennsylvania. So I'm going to throw out a couple other terms that the court talked about. And the court talked about that in a project like this, when you do fracturing, the length of the fractures from the well, so you have the horizontal well and you do the hydraulic fracturing process, that these fractures are measured in three different ways. So number one is the hydraulic length. And what that is that is the distance that the fracking fluid will travel from the wellbore. So remember, you got this wellbore going horizontally 5-10,000 feet below the surface. They then fracture it. There is water and chemicals that are part of that fracturing process that are now going to migrate or travel away from the wellbore. So that's the hydraulic length. It's the distance of this fluid will travel from the wellbore. And that can be sometimes, even the court says, as far as 3,000 feet from the well itself. That's one part. Second part is the what they call the propped length, P-R-O-P-P-E-D, propped. The propped length, which is slightly shorter distance, is where the proppant will reach, meaning the sand that they're using to prop open these rocks that they've now exploded. So we have the fluid, then we have the proppant. That's going to be shorter distance than the fluid. But then we have what's called the effective length, and that's even shorter. And the effective length is the distance within which the hydraulic fracturing operation will actually improve production. So that's saying where the actual fracturing is improving production, meaning that water may flow 3,000 feet away from the wellbore, but that's not resulting actually in natural gas coming to the wellbore as a result of water migrating very far away from the wellbore. But closer to the wellbore, you have this effective length where, as a result of this fracturing, the proppant, the sand, you're now seeing better results, and you're seeing that there's improved production as a result of this fracturing. So these are three different things to look at. And what we're looking at again is there an action for an adjoining landowner when a wellbore is drilled in close proximity to his property, such that as a result of hydraulic fracturing, gas is now moving from his property, and he's not leased to the gas company, and is going into the well and being paid the royalty to others. Is there an action for the unleased neighboring landowner for trespass and conversion, also we would call stealing gas? You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Make sure you join me each and every week at this time on this station for All Things Marcellus. So this is the issue that the Superior Court had to address. So in addressing this, they look out to other states and they say, you know, there's only a couple other states that have really ruled on this. And I'll just highlight a couple of items here. In the Texas case called Coastal Oil, they ruled for the gas company and said, you know, there was no claim. But in the Stone case in West Virginia, we have the opposite ruling. So one of the items that the Stone court cited was the dissent in the Texas case, meaning a judge wrote an opinion on the other side saying that he disagreed with the actual majority of the court's opinion. And this is just interesting language. It says that the Coastal Oil opinion gives oil and gas operators a blank check to steal from the small landowner. Under such a rule, the companies may tell a small landowner that either they sign a lease on the company's terms, or the company will just hydraulically fracture under the property, meaning from next door, and take the oil and gas without compensation. In the alternative, a company may take the gas without even contacting the landowner. So even the Texas judge said, you know what, this is crazy. Because if you allow this, a company can just bypass smaller properties entirely and never lease them and just drill in close proximity, fracture as long as they're not underneath that property, and take their gas and never give them a dime. Or if that landowner is lucky, the company could say, we're going to give you the worst lease in the world that just complies with Pennsylvania law, and we're going to, you either take it, or if you don't, we'll drill around you and we'll, you know, steal your gas, take your gas. So even the Texas judge in the dissent said, you know, this is problematic, but the majority said, no, that's okay. But West Virginia ultimately concluded that hydraulic fracturing beneath a neighbor's land without consent constituted an actionable trespass, meaning you could sue the gas company for trespass if you were not leased and they drilled close to your property. So we have Texas saying one thing, West Virginia saying something else, and we have one more segment to go, and we're going to tell you what Pennsylvania said. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Remember, give us a call. I got to say it again. Multi-unit well consents really hot now. If you're just signing, in my opinion, you're making a big mistake. Give us a call. Learn about reviews, consultations, any and all oil and gas needs. 570-307-0702. 570-307-0702. I'll be right back, and we're going to talk about what did the Pennsylvania courts decide right after this break. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Remember to join me each and every week at this time on this station for All Things Marcellus. And give us a call. Learn about reviews, consultations, multi-unit well consents, you name it. Give us a call. And if this case impacts you, give us a call. 570-307-0702. So here we go. What does Pennsylvania do? Win one for the landowner. Pennsylvania says, this is a Pennsylvania court, Briggs versus Southwestern. We are persuaded by the analysis in Coastal Oil's dissent and the Stone case from West Virginia, and the Pennsylvania court concludes that hydraulic fracturing is distinguishable from conventional methods of oil and gas extraction. Traditionally, the rule of capture assumes that oil and gas originate in subsurface reservoirs or pools, lakes of gas, and can migrate freely within this reservoir and across property lines, according to the changes of pressure within that reservoir. The flow of gas to places of lesser pressure does not respect property lines. They stated further that unlike oil and gas originating in a common reservoir beneath the ground, natural gas, when trapped in a shale formation, is non-migratory, meaning it's not going to just migrate to the neighboring property. Said further, shale gas does not merely escape to adjoining lands absent the application of external force, and that external force being hydraulic fracturing. The court also noted that many natural gas discoveries are made in tight, relatively impermeable rocks, and natural gas will not flow easily from these tight reservoirs without some assistance. Instead, the shale must be fractured through the process of hydraulic fracturing. Only then the natural gas contained in the shale moves freely through the artificially created channels. Remember the stone or the sand propping open these stone channels that gas can flow through. Court goes on, references that the rule of capture precludes liability for capturing oil or gas drained from a neighboring property whenever such flow occurs solely through the operation of natural agencies in a normal manner, as distinguished from artificial means applied to stimulate that gas flow. Meaning, the court is saying, look, we applied the rule of capture to conventional drilling when there's this underground lake or reservoir of gas, but you're using artificial means. You're using hydraulic fracturing. The gas isn't just naturally flowing that way. They go on, hydraulic fracturing is a costly and specialized endeavor, and the traditional recourse to go and do likewise, meaning go drill your own vertical well or go drill your own well on your property, is not something that's readily available to the average landowner. These wells cost $5, $6 million, $7 million to drill. So in the old days, they say, hey, you don't like the guys stealing your gas next door, go drill your own well on your property and you get whatever gas you can from the underground reservoir. Well, you're not able to do that so easy in a horizontal drilling, the wells that cost $5, $6, $7 million and maybe even more to drill. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. So the Pennsylvania court went on to state that they echoed or agreed with the concern that the coastal oil dissent judge raised in the Stone Court in West Virginia, stated that precluding this type of trespass liability based on the rule of capture would effectively allow the gas company to expand its lease by locating a well near the boundary of leased property that they own and then withdraw gas from the neighboring property where they don't have a lease. The court said, hey, that's a problem. Remember, now the gas company could just bypass the small property, drill close to it, and extract all the gas from it. Or they could offer them a terrible lease and say, hey, sign it or don't, we'll steal your gas. The Pennsylvania court again goes on to state that such allowance to allow this would nearly eradicate the gas company's incentive to negotiate leases with small property owners, as the company could use hydraulic fracturing to create an artificial channel beneath the unleased adjoining property owner and then withdraw natural gas from beneath that unleased neighboring property owner and not pay that person a royalty. So the Briggs court concluded, the Pennsylvania court concluded on April 2nd that the rule of capture does not preclude liability for trespass due to hydraulic fracturing. Again, the Briggs court concluded on April 2nd, 2018, that the rule of capture does not preclude or does not stop an action by an unleased landowner to say you're trespassing and stealing my gas. Think about that. So anytime this landman comes to your house and says, oh, we're going to steal your gas, we're going to steal your gas. Are you familiar with the case of Briggs versus Southwestern, where the court went on and said, therefore, hydraulic fracturing may constitute an actionable trespass where the subsurface fractures, fracturing fluid and proppant crosses boundary lines and extends into the subsurface estate of the adjoining property owner for which the gas company does not have a lease and then extracts natural gas from beneath the non-leased landowner. Let me say that again. This case says that if you are not leased and the company is taking gas from underneath your property as a result of their hydraulic fracturing, you have an action. You can sue them. This is a game changer, guys. Game changer. If you're unleased and your property is within a unit and they're drilling beside you, you have an action. I want to hear from you, of course, but you have an action. So go back, listen to this show again, pagasleaseattorney.com, pipelineattorney.com. Check out the Briggs versus Southwestern Energy case. Huge, huge deal. You think this impacts you, I want to hear from you, 570-307-0702. This is going to be a big deal. I'm going to talk about this more next week, but I'm up against it today. You've been listening to All Things Marcellus with me, attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Remember, the landman works for the company, not you, the landowner. Stop signing bad agreements. I have not, I do not, and I will not work for a gas or pipeline company. Give us a call, 570-307-0702, and join me each and every week for All Things Marcellus at this time on this station. Have a great week, everyone.